The Rockstar Superhero Podcast is graciously sponsored by Justin Richards, founder and principal at Team Richards Realty Group in Bellevue, Washington. When the average agent you meet on the street sells fewer than four homes a year, experience matters. Justin and his team rely on more than 30 years combined experience, multiple financial market up and down swings, and hundreds of properties sold when advising their clients on their next sound investment or pricing a home for sale. Their goal is always very simple: achieve the best home price results in a time frame that suits your needs, all with the least amount of stress to you as a buyer or seller. For more information, visit TeamRichardsRealty.com. That's TeamRichardsRealty.com. Or call Justin Richards at 425-765-8088. And now, on with the podcast. So I can't explain at all what happened on the interview I conducted this evening, but I can say this, that it was an incredible, beautiful, intimate experience with a legend in the post-hardcore music world. That is Thomas Erak from The Fall of Troy. I seriously am still floored and flabbergasted. I don't even know how to record this introduction. The conversation just stayed in a really lovely place. Place that I wasn't expecting, a place of everything from, I don't know, joy and frustration to alienation and conventionality. It was just loaded to the gills with truth. And that's something you just don't get anymore. I mean, seriously, man. I mean, you can hear it in my voice. I don't even know what was going on. I just know I experienced something so extraordinary tonight. And, you know, even creating this introduction feels silly because it's like me trying to bookend, I don't know, you know, the greatest American novel. And it's not that my interview was so incredible. It was just, there was this incredible thing that happened in the air, this beautiful intangible that I'll never be able to explain. So I guess I'll just have to say, you guys got to listen to this interview because it was incredible. Man, ladies and gentlemen, Thomas Erak from The Fall of Troy. You're going to dig it. How much did your dad warn you about me in advance? Like, well, watch out for this guy. He's really weird.
He told me he met you, yeah, like 16 years ago at a piano shop. Where was the piano shop?
It was in Bellevue. It was a place called Washburn Piano, and your dad showed up right around 2000, 2001. And, you know, you end up talking about the stuff you do, and he talks about bass, and I talk about drums, and next thing you know, we're talking about, you know, getting together, and that never happened, actually. I went and saw shows he did. He went and saw shows I did, but we never played together. He's a great player. I really dig his style.
He's one of a kind.
Yeah. Well, he's one of a kind in every way, right? I mean, probably good and bad.
Yeah, well, I'd like to say that they don't make him like that anymore.
Yeah.
But I just think he broke the mold. Like, I don't think they've ever, I think he's a one-of-a-kind model. I don't think they've made one like him or before or after or since. You know, I think he's just kind of, he is who he is. He's an amazing guy. I love my dad. He's pretty cool, man.
Yeah, he's a ferocious cat. I mean, what I love about him when you watch him play, he's just transported into another world. He becomes another person. He becomes the thing he was created to be, you know? And just hanging out with him, he cares so much about people. I mean, you know what I mean? He really, really wants to know what you're thinking and what your input is. he wants you to listen too, but he's really open to your ideas, and I think that's what makes him so killer. He's really, really on. He gets on a wavelength and he stays on it. He's paying attention, and that's huge.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think the trance is authentic. Yeah, you know,
that's a great way to put it. Well, I know we're both.
No, I know it is for me too. You know, like as a performer, and I learned a lot from him. And I just think that, I mean, I'm not religious.
Right.
I don't tote myself as being like necessarily super spiritual or like, you know, any kind of anything like that. I don't know. The closest thing I've ever gotten to seeing the face of God is being on stage.
Yeah.
So like that's for real to me. That's very, very for real. That's not a joke.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, playing music and, yeah, it's not funny. It's not something I take lightly, and I don't think it's something my dad has ever taken lightly, and it's supposed to be fun, and it is fun. But it's not fun if it sucks, you know?
Right.
So I was kind of brought up with that idea, like music's fun, but it's serious. It's not a hobby.
Yeah.
No, it's
it counts.
It's who you are. It's your therapy. It's your, you know, until this day, you know, I can go in my bedroom with a guitar and really say what I want to say to myself.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't have that in their lives. A lot of people don't get to talk to themselves. You know, they have to find that in other avenues, which is fine as well. But for me, I just feel very fortunate and lucky that I have a gift that I feel like I was half born with and I half learned from my dad.
Yeah.
To be able to express myself in this really intangible way. That is very authentic and very real and very serious.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I totally get that. It's funny because, you know, I discovered you through your dad. I'm a few years younger than your dad, but you know, I'm in his generation, if you will. Right. And, and so it's one of those things when you're a kid, you tell yourself there's three things you're never going to grow out of. You're always going to be into roller coasters. You're always going to be into fireworks, and you're always going to listen to the current pop music. You know what I mean?
And I'd agree with the first two.
Exactly. That's exactly the truth. That's exactly what happens. I'm still into those, but the last one, I found myself falling off this cliff, and I really kind of stuck in the, you know, I'm stuck in the 70s and early 80s, and there's, you know, there's influential bands that popped in the 90s and obviously in the thousands, but nothing that caught me as much as the romanticism of what music, how it caught me when I was 10, 11, 12,
right.
You know, 15, that sort of thing, you know?
Right. Yeah, totally. I mean, I think half of that is nostalgia, definitely.
Yeah.
I think everybody has that.
Yeah.
Where, you know, when you first hear something for the first time, it strikes you in such a way that you never forget it and you never get that feeling again.
Yeah.
I also think that I'm very jealous that you got to grow up in that time. I think I was the last generation that like remembers when there was no cell phones.
Yeah.
Was like kind of before the internet. Like I kind of grew up in the generation like where the internet like became, it was born. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. I totally get that. I mean, you're the last generation that grew up with media. You had to go buy it at a store and you didn't necessarily get all access. You ended up hearing what was on the radio, you know, it was a hit or something, or maybe
right.
A friend of your father's told you, hey, you should go buy this record because it's a classic. It's a Blue Note record. And then you have to go to the store and find it. So you have to really care about it.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Yeah, I guess my point with that was I could understand what you're saying. But what I don't think it was congruent about that is I don't think the music changed. I think everything else around it did and still is and always has, you know? I just think that, like, rock and roll particularly, I think especially, you know, after the 90s and especially once the internet came into play, mm-hmm. all the really good rock music kind of went underground, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it wasn't on the radio, you know? I mean, I could give you a list of bands you've never heard before that you'd probably love, and you'd be like, how did I not hear this?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
You know, because the internet and advertising and money kind of took over art. It kind of took over, the 90s was kind of rock and roll's last stand, I feel like.
Yeah.
Now it's in this weird place where your record is truly a billboard for your live show, which I think is fine for me because, I mean, I've always prided myself and my band on being a live band.
Yeah.
You know, I think we need some great records, but I think our live experience is what it's all about. So, like giving our music away for free, it's not that big of a deal as long as you're moving tickets and t-shirts, you know? And I think that's true for bands that are big and bands that are small at this point.
Yeah, well, you know, it's funny because there's negatives and positives to growing up when you grew up, right? You are correct in that you are sort of the last generation of the way things used to be. And yet, you know, you grew up kind of in the middle of when about once a decade there would be, you know, I don't want to be mean to anything, right? I try not to be a naysayer about certain types of music maybe I don't listen to, but you know, whether it's New Kids on the Block or NSYNC, when that really, really high sheen pop pabble comes through, it kind of cleanses the palate. And the difference was when you came into the business, I don't want to call you an underground band, but it went underground, right? And the great groups came out of nowhere. And then all of a sudden when YouTube appeared on the, you know, on the horizon, what, in 05, 06, it became the new medium. And it's funny because yes, it's a visual medium, but I mean there's a lot of audio only
on
there.
It's also an audio medium. I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
Totally, man.
Yeah.
We're definitely an underground band though. Like, yeah. I don't make sense to that at all. That's just that.
Well, I think that's a good thing. I mean when you get down to it, you really do want to control your destiny. I mean, just talking to you in the last 10 minutes, you're an artist, and that means you care more. You give a shit more about the music and the art and what it means, how it's interpreted, and the legacy of it. You care more about those three things, at least I'm assuming, than you do about the dollar. Now, wouldn't you love to make a great living doing those three things?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I really fucked myself good, huh?
tell me how you did.
I don't know. Yeah, it'd be great to do those three things and make a ton of money doing it. But, you know, I can't remember exactly who it was. I want to say it might have been Lauryn Hill.
Okay.
That I believe had a quote back in the 90s when the Fugees were, they had that Killing Me Softly cover out, that Roberta Flack cover out. Do you remember right. that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
I love Lauryn Hill. So,
I do too. So
I think Miseducation is one of the most, I think so many people are uneducated about R&B. I think that record is so underrated. It's just, it blows my mind. Anyways. But I think she said something like, you know, it's hard because, like, you see all these artists, quote unquote, or whatever, that you know, write these stories about their quote-unquote lives. And then you have real artists that really do write stories about their lives. You know, like, would you rather listen to a, you know, a gangster rap song by some dude that grew up in Bellevue, you know, a white kid that grew up in Bellevue and is talking about, you know, cars and bitches and money and Oxycontin? Or right. Do you want to listen to, you know, NWA Straight Out of Compton?
Absolutely, because it's real and it bleeds, right? It bleeds.
The trance is authentic, yeah, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
nothing, yeah. In my head, nothing is greater than Chuck D's voice. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Chuck D's voice is perfect. That almost, I mean, whatever he.
That's Public Enemy. That's Public
Excuse
Enemy.
Excuse me. That's what I meant to say. That's what I meant to say. But I love Chuck D's voice. I love it.
Dude, well, he's like the preacher prophet of hip hop, man.
Yeah. It's an amazing thing.
I'm a big hip hop fan.
Clearly. So, although I screwed up with the whole NWA Public Enemy thing, because I know the difference. I got to tell you a little story really quick before we continue. I had a colonoscopy 2 hours ago, and I'm still coming down. I'm still coming down from the drugs. So if I'm not quite there, my apologies. And I'm trying, man. I'm really freaking trying.
That makes it more fun.
Yeah. I wanted to say something, if you don't mind. You know, in a way to start this off, because obviously we've just kind of jumped out of the chute. I try to make these just really conversational. I didn't want this to be a question and answer thing. You know, I think your fans, you know, if any of your fans end up listening to this, they kind of already know the main scoops about you. And the truth is I'm asking for me, right? That's what I'm doing. But
sure.
To me, I wanted to say one thing because it popped in my head the moment, the very first time I heard your music, the very first time. And I admittedly don't remember the name of the track. I can probably find it here really quick. But to me, you are quite literally the Dweezil Zappa of your generation. And I hope that means something to you, because it means an absolute shitload to me. Dweezil is the real deal, and he cares about legacy so much. And to see what's going on with him and his family right now is very heartbreaking. But nonetheless, he's an incredible player, and I love that he carries his father's... He became his father's muse. Or, excuse me, his father became his muse. And
definitely.
And he's jumped and pushed it forward. And I love that continuation. Again, that legacy and that blood. And even though you and your father share the same name, you're radically different types of players. And I know your dad brought a lot to the table, a ton, right? A lot of influence and you know,
a lot of thought process, more than anything, like outside of the box.
Yeah.
You don't have to color inside of the lines all the time.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. I mean, when your dad sends me a text, it's like I'm reading poetry. Seriously. It's craziness. It's crazy.
I'm sorry. I take the blame for that. I taught him how to text.
Well, anyway, I just wanted to say that. I wonder what your thoughts are on the Dweezil thing, because that's a really significant...
My initial reaction was to say, you know, I mean, I would have taken Frank over that, but...
Sure.
No, that's a big compliment. You know, I'm familiar with Dweezil Zappa, but not familiar enough to really say a lot about that.
I understand.
You know what I mean? But to kind of tie into that, I mean, the first real concert I ever went to when I was like 10 or 11 years old, my dad took me to see Primus.
Awesome. Was it at the Paramount? Was it the Paramount?
It was the Paramount. Was it the Tales from the Punchbowl tour.
I was there.
It was 95.
I was there. I was in the first row of the balcony.
Yeah, they came off the. They came out in the penguin suits.
Yeah, it was lovely. The bass. I've never felt that much bass in my life at a show.
Yeah, and it was funny because, I mean, I've seen Primus now, like, I don't even know how many times, But I took my dad for his birthday, not like, I think probably 3 years ago when they came through doing their Willy Wonka thing.
Yeah, I didn't get a chance, but I heard it was killer.
Yeah, just me and him went to that, and it'd been so long since me and him had just like gone to a show together, you know?
Right.
I mean, because when I live in Detroit now, but like when I was living in Seattle still, you know, when I'd hang out with my dad, it would usually be at a venue. We know a lot of musicians. We're in the community there.
Right.
But that was fun because it was like, it was just him and I, you know, like it wasn't a social event. It was like, we went to see Primus.
Right. It was meant to be shared between you two.
Yeah. And it was cool to like, I don't know, it kind of came full circle, I guess, in kind of a cheesy father, son, big fish moment kind of way or something, where like, you know, my dad took me to see Primus for my first show. And so I finally got to take my dad to see Primus.
Nice. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with a big fish moment, man. You're gonna want to get as many in as you can because those moments stop. I lost my father in August this year, and I regret every second of time I didn't spend with him. So I'm glad you guys have such a good relationship.
Yeah, we lost my grandfather last year too. I'm sure my dad probably spoke about that to you.
Yeah, he did. We ended up crying together on the phone for a bit.
Yeah,
he was pretty heartbroken. Well,
yeah, I'm still really heartbroken. I mean, he was my hero.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, my grandpa was as much my dad as my dad. I mean, it's just been tough. It's really turned our whole family upside down, and especially with me being out here now, and I just, it's hard, man.
And you're 31 now, right?
What I always like to say about my grandpa is, my grandpa is the guy that taught me everything I know about being a man and everything I know about not being a man.
Wow.
He's the one that taught me that. You know, my dad gave me the gift of music and gave me a best friend. My grandpa gave me a hero.
Wow.
So,
yeah. I don't know anything about, admittedly, about your family life, and I don't know how comfortable you are talking about that, but I don't know anything about your mother. I don't know if you have a relationship with her. I don't know where she lives. I don't even know if she's alive. I just you know what I mean? And are you open to sharing a little bit of that, or is it just too tight?
Totally. Yeah, okay. Definitely. Yeah, I'm all about family. Yes, my mom is alive.
Cool.
She lives in Mukilteo.
Okay.
We do have a relationship. I love her very much. She's my mom. She's a lot different than my dad. She's pretty. I really, for lack of a better word, I want to say conservative, not politically.
Mm-hmm.
I really hesitate to use that word. I think she's just, my mom's just kind of hardcore. You know what I mean? She's kind of like,
she's a mom.
It's her way or the highway, man. You know, like,
I like that.
And if you don't like that, then tough shit.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I found that family, family's one of those. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I, jump? I'm go ahead and finish. We have a slight delay and I get a bump. So I thought you were done. I'm sorry.
Oh no, that's fine. Yeah, no, she, but when it comes down to it, when it's always come down to it, my mom is always the first person to be there for me. You know, she's always, always there for me. Even if, I mean, I will get my ass reamed, but she will be there for me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
She's always there for me. So yeah, I love my mom. We definitely have a tumultuous relationship, but, always interesting. And I do like hanging out with her no matter what she thinks.
Yeah.
And I have a lot of my mom in me, you know? I have a lot of my mom in me. More than I think she thinks a lot of the time. I have an older sister.
Yeah.
That I love dearly as well. Yeah, and then, you know, grandpa was the homie. You know, grandma's, that's a tough subject for me.
Sure,
at this point.
Sure.
Since grandpa went, you know, grandma's just kind of just waiting, you know?
Yeah, it's the worst. It's the worst.
Yeah, it's rough. Yeah. But she's the most wonderful woman that's ever lived. My dad has a sister, Aunt Susie, who's one of the funniest women I've ever met. Yeah, and I just, I've been really lucky to have a very diverse but supportive family.
Yeah.
Like, very diverse, very different personalities going on, big time melting pot family, you know?
Yeah, that's cool.
But still supportive of me and my endeavors, you know?
Yeah, there's something in that Croat blood, right? There's this amazing thing that comes from.
Oh, man. I don't know.
I'm telling you, I really think there is. It's just this incredible gift that I hate the term ethnicity because, I mean, to me, we're all ethnic, right? I mean, and we're all human, right? I hate the term race. I hate it. My wife is Japanese. She's not a different race. We're all human race. She's just Japanese. She was born on an island. I was born on this island. You know what I mean? It's just
culture.
It's just people.
Culture,
exactly.
Is the word you're looking.
Exactly. It's culture. And how much of that Croatian culture, you know, came through, bled through into you? Because, I mean, your father, obviously, your grandfather.
Grandpa.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. How about your mother? Is your mother Croat as well?
No,
okay,
no.
Okay.
My mom's not Croat. But I definitely, I think I definitely got a lot of that blood. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, you got the look, that's for sure.
Yeah, I definitely got a lot of that blood.
You got the mane. You got that hair.
Yeah. Well, I mean,
awesome.
You know, Papa Joe, Grandpa's dad, was from the old country, you know?
Yeah.
He was from Croatia. And so it's not that far removed, you know?
Yeah.
Whether or not I can speak the language or whatever, that's not what culture is. You know?
Yeah.
To me, culture is, it's not race. It's not, it's like, it's knowledge of, a bigger picture than yourself. You know, it's, you come from a long line of things and it just, kind of is how it is, you know, and a lot of, we have all these crazy old sayings and generalizations and things and all these things that people like to say, like, oh, I hate that saying and blah, blah, blah. But like, they exist because these are real things,
right?
You know, like, they exist and that's okay. That's not racist. You know, it
yep.
just, it is how it is, you know.
I love it. I think you're talking about intangibles, you know, that beautiful thing that
yeah,
just...
it's kind of, it's hard to put into words,
yeah.
You know, like, and that's, I think, a huge part of my life and why I do what I do and why I've lived the life I've lived. And half of it, I mean, playing music is only half of it, man. The traveling is what's really been, and the culture I've gained from the traveling and the people I've met and the people I've spent time with in other places of the world that I never would have gone, are really what make it really special.
It's awesome. It's awesome.
Cause if I didn't care about that, then like I said, I'd just go into my bedroom with my guitar and play my songs for myself all the time.
Yeah. And there's catharsis there, but it doesn't, you know, but you exist to make the world better, right? I mean, you bring your secret to the world.
I don't, No, I don't think. I don't look at it like that. No, I look at it like. I'm really lucky to be in the position that I'm in to meet amazing people and then be able to interact with them and have them in my life and be a part of their life and be able to write stories or document in an intangible way either my experience with these people or what I believe their experience is with me or what their experience is within themselves. You know, I'm a mirror. I just hold a mirror up to the world.
Wow.
I don't, you know, it's not, no. No, it's not.
My God, I'd like to hang out with you, man. You're the most interesting human I think I've ever talked to. You have such a unique perspective. And to have it bleed out of you the way it does at the age you're at, it almost makes me mad that I didn't learn more when I was a younger man. You know, I'm 50 years old, and, you know, I've been influenced by a lot of fabulous things, and I've made a lot of great choices in my life. And granted, I made some bad choices. That's what, you know, that's life, right?
Sure.
But I just listen to the wisdom in your words. You're very, very thoughtful.
The grass is always greener, man. Grass is always greener on the other side. I've never had a credit card. You know, I've never, I'm 31 years old. This is the first time I've ever been on a lease in my entire life.
Yeah.
No.
Kind of sucks.
But it rules, man.
Yeah. Like,
it's the stupidest shit, you know? Like one of the first big arguments I ever got into with my now fiance, Jenica, was over dishes.
Yeah.
You know? Because I've been living in hotel rooms since I was 16, 17 years old, you know?
Yeah.
And like, I did the dishes and be like, hey, I did the dishes. And she's like, what do you want me to do? A fucking backflip? You know? Like, what? Good job? You know? And like, I really thought it was like a big deal. And,
but it was a big deal. She just didn't understand it because
to me at the time, it was.
It's two different levels of numbness, Thomas. You just have two different worlds, and you're having to figure out how to combine those worlds. It's tough, and it'll always be tough.
What I've learned from her. We'll get into her later too, I hope.
Well, if you want to, I'm open. I'm an open book, brother.
One of the big things I've learned from her is the dishes are never done, man.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, that's so true. That's so true. Oh, my gosh. Oh, well.
Yeah, I mean, that's deep, right? But I mean, it's surface, but it's deep, too. I mean, as soon as you think those dishes are done, someone's hungry.
Yeah.
Like the second you're finally like, oh, they're done. Put them all away.
Right. Her argument is right up there with, you know, hey, you're going to use the restroom and you're going to go wipe your ass. But you know what? You're going to have to use the restroom tomorrow. So why wipe your ass? Right? It's that same idea that there's always more. It's more coming. You don't get a reward. You don't get a prize. Just do what you have to do to maintain. Right?
That's right. And she, you know, she's 31. We're the same age. And she's a musician as well.
Cool.
But she's also a mother.
Yeah.
And has been a single mother since she was 23 years old, you know?
Wow. 22,
23 years old. And it's like there's just something about that is just – the word I like to use is unfuckwithable.
Yeah.
Like, she has better things to do than argue with me about inane shit. You know what I mean? Like, she's a very ambitious. Everything she has, she earned. You know, she worked for. herself and with a little boy and took care of that little boy. Like, you know, I can kiss her ass. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, yeah.
But it's also very interesting because I've lived this equally kind of heavy life on a totally different end of the spectrum, you know?
Yeah.
Like, we've both been through some pretty serious shit, you know, one way or another. And we come together over things like food and music.
Yeah.
And art.
Normalcy.
Family. And the things that have always brought human beings together.
Yeah.
We're starting to forget what brings us all together these days.
Wow.
We're all getting lost in our cell phones and our fucking computers and our, you know?
Yeah.
We're starting to forget what it's like to create our own power and be our own power.
Did you know?
And give each other power.
Yeah, did you know Dave Dayton in Seattle?
I don't think so.
Guitar player, played with Kuma back in 03, 04, 05. He and I had a band as well called Swerve back in the late 90s. Long story short is Dave had a heart failure quite young, 43, 44, and passed away last year. And yeah, he was amazing. But it's the reason I ask is because the things you're saying are things that people who live in the deepest recesses of their art, right? They refuse to kowtow to society, and they find ways to be very social. I mean, you're a kind, easy to talk to guy, and I'm sure you're very social. I've never hung out with you, but you're certainly nice, you know, talking with me tonight, and you're expressing lovely things and about your fiance. But I hear in you that disdain for what the world and the government and all these other things tell us we should want and have. Right? Am I correct? Because Dave always said, kill your TV. Shoot that motherfucker. Kill your TV. And
I totally get that. I don't know about, I don't personally feel that way. Like, I think technology is very fascinating and important.
Okay.
But I think overdoing anything is indulgent, you know?
Yeah.
It's like my grandma said way back in the day when I was a little boy, even too many popsicles will kill you.
It's so true.
And popsicles are goddamn delicious.
That is the quote.
It was like Jenica was saying to me, she was telling me to her son, Aubin, the other day, and they were having some kind of discussion, and like money came up, and like he's seven. Wow. So he doesn't really he hasn't grasped the idea of like money yet fully. You know, like bills came up, and he was like, you know, what are bills? And she was like the TV, the lights, the heat, you know, the clothes you're wearing, everything costs money. Bills. She's like, you know, the food that we ate for breakfast this morning, like everything costs money, you know? And he was just like, and I think he feels the exact same way that I feel about it. And he's seven and I'm 31.
Yeah.
And I'm like, why the fuck do we have to pay for food? Why do people have to starve, man? Like, why do people hurt each other? Like, why do there's just some things that don't make sense to me, you know? Like,
yeah.
If someone wants to smoke a joint, like, let them smoke a joint. Like, who cares? You know what I mean? Like, I don't. I mean, I get it. I get capitalism and I get all that, but I just think, I don't know, just some things just shouldn't, you shouldn't have to work so hard for so little, you know?
Yeah.
Nobody should. Nobody should.
Yeah.
You know? Nobody should have to work just to live. You know, just to live, you know, in Sweden, there's a whole district that the government puts you up and gives you a flat and pays you and feeds you if you're an artist.
Yeah. Amazing.
Like, what the fuck, you know, like, what? And here we are in America, you know, like, living the fucking dream or whatever, quotation marks with my fingers.
Yeah. And bragging about it, right?
To put Donald Trump into office, a man that has openly stated he hates rock and roll music.
of thousands of other things?
Rob, I don't even want to go down it. But yeah, no, I know what you're saying, but to bring that back around, I really vibed with Aubin on that one. Like, I totally felt what he was saying, you know? He was just like, what, Mom? Like, we have to pay for food?
Yeah.
You know, like, food should be free. Everybody has to eat food.
Yeah.
You know, like, so yeah, I don't think it's, I get the whole, like, kill your TV thing and all that. But I mean, if it wasn't for, you know, the TV, quote unquote, or the computer or the internet, I wouldn't be able to stay in touch with my dad the way I'm able to stay in touch with my dad living out here now.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be able to, you know, stay in touch with my best friends back home. I wouldn't be able to, you know what I mean? Like, I just think people need to know when to put it down a little bit more and live a little more.
Yeah, no, I agree with you totally. My friend Dave, his whole perspective was the fact that he knew he wasn't going to live a long life. He wasn't going to, you know, get to a grand old ripe age of 80 or 90. He had failing heart valves and he knew they were a death sentence. He just didn't know how long. And so to him, it was live every inch like it's the last inch. You know what I mean?
Totally. And I totally agree with that, man. Yeah. I'm totally with your man on that one.
Yeah.
I live every minute of my life like it's my last, because, dude, I have no idea, man.
Yeah.
I mean, I hope I get to be an old man someday with a bunch of tattoos and
you know, yeah,
all that stuff. And,
is that you, Grandpa, on the TV?
I don't expect it, though. Yeah. You know, I don't expect it. I've treated myself pretty rough already, so I guess the rest of my life is about trying to make up for the damage I've already done to my life.
Well, you seem I would never call you, based on what I know about your career, I wouldn't call you Kurt Cobain, right? That's done two or three really big things, and then you're just going to burn out because, you know, you're a shooting star. I think what you are is a true artist. I mean, the reason I threw the Dweezil Zappa thing in the very beginning was...
Nirvana's my favorite band of all time.
Oh, that's cool. That's cool. Yeah.
And there's a lot of theories about Kurt Cobain, but at the end of the day, I think Kurt Cobain... big star or not, I think he was a very troubled young man.
Oh yeah.
But I think he was brilliant.
Yeah.
I think it's too bad.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I think it's too bad.
Yeah. But anyways, I agree.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, I agree. We could go round and round about that. I agree wholeheartedly. I think he, I actually believe he's underappreciated. Like, if more people could hear how good he truly was and really analyze it and listen to it deeper than the surface, right? Don't just have me, don't just plug in three or four hits into my brain. Have me sit down in the dark and listen to, I don't know, name a record, right? Sit me
in Utero is my favorite. Yeah, the last one.
Yeah, it's my favorite as well because it's the darkest and it's the rawest and it feels real.
I think it's the prettiest.
Yeah.
I think it's the prettiest as well.
I love
it's
the
definitely
bass
the
tones.
Easiest and the weirdest and the darkest, but it's also the prettiest. Yeah. You have like Dumb and Pennyroyal Tea and All Apologies. Like these are beautiful songs, and not only beautiful songs. These are songs that can be played at a million watts with distortion pedals, or can be played on an acoustic guitar in your living room.
Yeah.
And they're just as good. And they're timeless.
Yeah.
All Apologies is still going to be a great song in 100 years, man.
Yeah. It's because it's a classic. It's carefully crafted. Right? That was something he took so seriously, so personally, to craft these songs, to make them timeless.
A true gift.
Yeah.
Truly gifted. It was truly a great songwriter.
I agree.
A great songwriter.
I agree. I think, you know, it's funny when I was getting into that question earlier about, you know, your family and specifically your mother, if you had a relationship with her, was I've noticed that families that have separations tend to be very inspiring for a growing musician, you know, and you,
right.
And you jumped out of the box so young and you played so well. I wondered what was a motivating factor, because I mean, you have, part of it has to be,
what was the catalyst?
Yeah, part of it has to be in your brain because you're just built that way, but then there has to be something that lights the fire. And what was that for you? If there was one.
A lot of things. I think my parents were very tumultuous, and not in tumultuous, like when I say me and my mother have a tumultuous relationship, like we do in every sense of the word. I mean, my parents were fucked up to each other.
Uh-huh.
But they loved each other and they still do. You know, we still have holidays together and stuff, and they're still friends, you know? Which I think is just, I mean, I really can't say anything to that. I think that speaks for itself, you know?
Yeah.
That, you know, but I was a very angry young man. I just had a lot of feelings. And I just, like, I don't know. I just, I was explaining this to my fiance the other night too. And we had this like really late night, like kind of long, deep talk. And, that we like, you know, rarely get to do, but, and I was explaining to her, like, I was never like the dork. I was never like the kid that like got made fun of, but I was never the cool kid either. But, and I was never the kid that fit in, but I was never the weirdo. But that's what made me the weirdo. It was like, I kind of like, by not fitting in anywhere, I kind of fit in everywhere.
Right. Or maybe, were you kind of fighting against that, meaning that?
No, I think I was searching for my own identity within myself.
Hmm.
You know, like trying to find what was special about me. Yeah. You know, because I didn't want to just be in the middle. I don't know. I didn't want that life, man. I didn't want to work in a cubicle and I didn't want a job. I didn't want a 9-to-5 and I feel till this day, man, I feel the power of love like so much. You know, good, bad, mean, nice, ugly, pretty, like I just feel love so heavily that it continues to just make me do this thing that I do. And it's just kind of always been that way, you know? Like, whether it's, like, looking for love or finding love or losing love, I just find that so fascinating. I love love, and I love love songs, and I've just been completely consumed by it my entire life, and I just can't see it any other way. And I know that sometimes, like, I'm not the toughest guy in the world, you know?
Right.
What makes you say that? When you say that, what do you mean by that?
First of all, physically, I'm a skinny
you are
Seattle that's yeah. You know, kind of a little bit more feminine than a lot of dudes understand yet. I have long hair, you know, I have tattoos on my hands and all over me, and
not enough vitamin D.
Yeah, I'm pale and I'm surrounded by pretty girls all the time.
Right.
So
that's
like
great.
either I'm gay or an alien to a lot of dudes.
Right.
So, you know, either or might be half true. I don't know.
Yeah.
But but really, I just think the power of expression is what drove me, you know?
Yeah.
Being able to, like, express anger or sadness or happiness or loneliness more than you could put into a sentence or a paragraph or a book, you know? You could put it in a song. You can literally say the words and then put the feelings you have inside of you behind that into a melody or into a groove or into, you can make somebody feel what you're feeling.
Right.
You know that feeling when it, like, stands the hair on the back of your neck up and you can't explain why?
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, it's built into you.
That.
Yeah.
That. Still does that, and I can do that to people. Why would I not spend my life doing that if I have the gift to be able to do that to people?
Yeah. Well,
why would I not do that?
Yeah, you're influencing people with that incredible honesty, and that honesty comes through art and music, right? And the visual nature of how you perform, everything about you screams sincerity. I mean, it's really real. I don't want to sidetrack you too much because I want you to keep going, but I caught it when I saw on YouTube. I was watching you when you sat in with Chon. You guys did I Just Got the Symphony Going, I think is what it was, if I remember correctly. And you freaking leveled the room with sincerity. You just meant every second of it playing. And the first time, I'm just saying this, I know it's a little bit of a long thing, but I first time I heard the song, I hadn't seen it, I'd only heard it, and I liked it, but it there was something about it, it didn't ring false, but I didn't get it. And then when I watched you, I was like, oh my God. And so my wife was cooking, and she comes in, and I go,
what the hell are you watching?
I know. Well, it was a little bit of that, because she was like, okay, he's singing and he's screaming and the music's all over the place and there's lots of, you know, you know what I mean? She doesn't necessarily understand it, but she appreciated it. She appreciated it. And she goes, I see why you love this. She actually said that out loud to me. I see why you love this.
I said, thank you.
Yeah, I will. It was just stunning, and that was the moment that it made sense to me. It's kind of like the first time you discover a band like, I don't know, Gojira, right? They're really heavy, and if you don't listen to what they're trying to say musically as well as lyrically, you're missing it.
Or like the Deftones.
Right, yeah, absolutely. Sure. Deftones. Well, perfect example. Absolutely. Same thing, right? And I don't mean the same thing, but I mean, you know what I'm saying. It has to count.
Yeah,
and it's the whole package.
Yes, totally. Like, the instruments themselves are telling the story as much as the words are.
Yeah.
If not more.
Yeah, and not just, of course, the tones, but the way the instrument's being played and how it shifts from tonight's performance to tomorrow night's performance. How the little tweaks sneak through, right? That's why, I mean, I never got the whole follow the Grateful Dead around the country. I never got it. And I'm not gonna lie, I still don't get it, mostly because I don't like their music. I just don't. I can appreciate it. I can totally appreciate it.
I've never been a fan.
Yeah, I just don't get
it. I know they're important. I respect them.
Yeah.
If I don't like it, I don't like it. Doesn't mean I hate it.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely. Or that it's bad. It's just not for me, but I do get why people would follow them, because they were looking for another gap to be filled the next night. You know, what did Mickey Hart give to me today? A lot. And tomorrow he's going to give me something new.
Well, we're all just trying to get off, man.
Yeah.
It's human nature. You know, life is love and love is life and fucking is God.
Yeah.
So
it's a pretty great thing.
Yeah, I mean music's that those moments on stage where it all clicks, like the only thing I can compare that to is an orgasm, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. Like, you know, it's fast and then it's slow, it's rough and it's soft, and it's like, but you got to time it all right or you'll fuck it up. And then it'll suck.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. To me, the beautiful thing about music is it lasts longer. you know what I mean? It's just, oh my goodness, it's so good.
You don't want to last too long. No. You don't want to overdo it either. You know, you got to do it right.
Then your ears get sore.
you gotta treat your guitar right. You know?
Yeah.
Take care of her.
I want to sit in a dark room and put an old Peter Gabriel album on and just sit there with my headphones on and listen to the music swirl around in my brain. That's just incredible stuff, man. That's incredible.
What
kind of music, you know, was playing at your house? You know, I mean, obviously your father had a lot of influences, things that turned him into who he was. And of course the people he played with over his career.
A lot of soul music.
I would have thought. Yeah.
Ray Charles, Sam Cooke, Otis Redding,
Aretha,
a lot of Motown. Yeah. Stuff like that. Then like, you know, the Beatles, Hendrix was huge.
Right.
Zeppelin.
Wow.
I didn't really get into the Stones until I went through puberty. I didn't really get the Stones until I like got it, you know, like I was like, they're just kind of like a shitty Beatles.
Yeah. They're a garage
band. And then I got a boner for the first time. And then I was like, now I get it. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. So true.
They're like the bad boy Beatles.
Yeah.
I get it.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that, and then, you know, my mom, I don't talk about my mom's musical influence on me very often, but, my mom isn't music inclined, okay, but she loves music, man. You know, like my mom has good taste. Like, in totally other areas than you would expect. I mean, my mom turned me on to Phil Collins, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Gloria Estefan, early Whitney Houston, you know, like, TLC, you know, like.
Well-produced, totally crafted pop. Well-produced stuff, right? Just well-written, well-performed.
Yeah. And yeah, and man, I love Phil Collins.
Yeah,
I really do. I need to get back around to that. It's been a minute. But, yeah, and, you know, and then my sister had a big influence on me as well, musically, because, you know, she's 4 years older than me.
Okay.
She's 35.
Okay.
So she was just a little bit older than me. And, but she was cool. So she had, like, older friends even, too. So yeah. She would, like, you know, bring CDs home or tapes home or whatever and be listening to them. And I'd be, like, interested, you know.
Yeah.
You know, Gail got me, you know, Gail showed me Weezer. You know, Gail showed me Nirvana. Gail showed me Green Day. Gail showed me No Doubt. You know what I mean? Like.
Yeah. I love that early 90s stuff, man. I love it. I mean, I think there was a period from 92 to about 97 that about 100 one-hit wonders came out that released incredible songs, just those one songs, but they're so damn good, like stuff by the Toadies or...
I was just going to say the Toadies. Rubberneck is actually a great record,
oh,
though.
It's so... I agree, but man, I mean, that one song is incredible.
Awesome game.
It's an incredible song. It's a perfect song, actually.
It rules, man.
Yeah.
I love that song.
Yeah.
And I mean, No Doubt, like, the name says it all.
Yeah.
I mean, early Green Day, like, Dookie blew my head off.
Yeah.
Dookie still blows my head off when I listen to it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. The first line of the record is, "I declare I don't care no more."
Perfect. You were the perfect age for that.
I'm burning out. Yeah, dude.
I was in the Navy the first time I heard that.
Me too, man. I'm 12. Let's do this.
Wow. That's hilarious.
Yeah, and then, you know, and then, like, I started to delve deeper, and I got into, like, Sunny Day Real Estate Weezer and, like, you know, and then, like, then I started to get into that, like, kind of more, even deeper into that kind of indie Seattle thing, like, Roadside Monument and The Blood Brothers and Minus the Bear and Pretty Girls Make Graves.
Yeah.
Sparkle. I mean, the list goes on and on. You know?
Yeah.
Like, oh, I grew up in, I was so lucky to, like, not only have an older sister that, like, had a driver's license that, like, you know, would drive me and my friends to shows. But, like, just the time we were in, you know, like, I mean, literally, you could go to the Paradox Theater 5 nights a week, and even if you hadn't heard any of the bands, you were going to walk out of there with a t-shirt or a CD or both, you know, of something.
Yep.
You know, or something. You were going to get something out of it. And yeah, I was just like, really, the Blood Brothers were, like, definitely one of those bands that, like, I remember the first time I saw the Blood Brothers, like, me and my friend Jay, who was my sister's age, who lived right next door, and he had a license too. So we'd go to shows together when my sister had better things to do. And he was a drummer, so we jammed together and we just went to shows. That's what we did.
Oh, man.
Almost every day. You know, we were either jamming, playing in drumline, or going to shows. That was it. We didn't have girlfriends. We liked girls, but we weren't there yet. But I remember seeing the Blood Brothers, and we'd, like, heard about this band from people and listened to them. I listened to, like, they had one song, like, up online. And I was like, it rocks. It's raw. But, like, I just don't get it. It kind of sounds like shit. You know, like, I don't see it.
Right.
And this kind of comes with what you were saying about our band.
Yeah.
And, you know, seeing it versus just hearing it. And I remember the first time I saw the Blood Brothers, and they came out on stage, and it was like, from the moment they hit their first note till they walked off stage, my jaw was on the fucking floor, man.
Yeah.
I was like, do I love this? Do I hate this? Is this my new favorite band? are these guys gay? Are they straight? Are these, is this real? Am I really here? Is this a real band? Like, can they do that?
Yeah.
Like, look around, like, can they do that? Like, you know, like, is that allowed?
Yeah, absolutely.
I was kind of scared. I didn't know if I was like, I might get hurt. You know, like, this is kind of dangerous, but it's exciting and I like it.
Yeah.
And it fucking got me off, man. Yeah. I loved it. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, I want to do that.
Yeah.
I want to do that. Like that and like Rage Against the Machine was another one that was just like.
Yeah, they meant it.
To say the least, dude.
Yeah, yeah, no doubt.
And at the drive-in.
Oh, of course. Yeah, actually, it's funny. When I first heard you guys, I hadn't really listened to much of At the Drive-In. And so, I mean, I realized they precede you. But my point being is that I had heard about them, but I'd never really investigated. So when I checked you guys out back when your dad told me about you, I went and listened at the drive-in because the first thing I thought of is you look like the singer, which is probably so silly. But that was what my brain was like. Well, that guy looks like him, so I wonder if they sound the same.
I don't have a sweet fro though.
No, you don't. But you know, you have a flowing mane. You do have a wild, untamed, you know, head of hair.
Thanks.
It's awesome.
I grew it myself.
That's awesome. Hey, I have three bands. I have three bands that I absolutely love that you may or may not know of, but they actually do to me what you were just talking about. There are three bands that I had seen perform that took me to a different place. One was Limb Lifter. They're from Vancouver. The second was Holly McNarland, who was on the Lilith Fair tour back in 97, 98.
Wow.
And she is, I mean, she's a genius, dude. You, if you want to see something where you pass out watching, it's Holly McNarland. It's mind-blowing how much she gets into the character of what she's singing about. And she just, I mean, she's a contortionist. She makes the strangest faces on stage, and her voice is just godly. It's just godly. So check her out if you don't know about her. And then the last was 24/7 Spies out of Baltimore, D.C. They were around when Fugazi was around, but I believe they're in New York now. And they've always been small. They'll probably always be small. But they were a band that mixed old school jazz and hip hop with absolute brutal heavy metal, and they are righteous. They are the thinking man's living color.
So kind of like Limp Bizkit before they like sucked totally?
Yeah, but I mean, but even...
That first, I don't care what anybody says, that first Limp Bizkit record
it's
is
awesome.
Incredible.
You know, it's awesome.
I think Wes Borland's...
Yes. You just said the magic word.
You know what? Really funny. He lives in the same town I live in.
Oh,
I've
really?
Had dinner with him like twice. I know him and his wife.
Oh,
like,
I admire
just
him.
just by normal life shit. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Not even through, really, like the music scene. Just through, like, you know, we had barbecue together one time, and you know, it was just so weird. And Jenica had no idea who he was.
Oh yeah,
she was like, "Why does everybody like care so much about this guy?" I was like. You don't know who Wes Borland is? She was like, no, like, what is the big deal?
Yeah.
I was like, that's awesome, and you're an idiot at the same time. Yeah, he's a really, I think he's a genius, man. I think he's underrated. And he actually plays guitar in his, just recently got married to his wife. She has a band called Queen Kwong.
Okay. Of course. Of course she does.
Yeah. And it is very interesting music, and their live show is killer.
Wow.
But he plays guitar with her sometimes. But yeah, it's just, it's crazy. Yeah, okay. That's cool.
Yeah. You got to check it out. Like,
yeah, definitely. Definitely. You know who else? You know, you brought up Lilith Fair, and that kind of got me thinking about, like, my sister has this phase of, like, kind of that thing, but, like, Tori Amos.
Right.
And, like,
oh God, I love
Fiona Apple.
Yeah, yeah, I love that.
And, you know, like, all those chicks, like, even, like, old Jewel was, like, kind of dark.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. And my fiance is, like, super, super, super into, like female singer-songwriter stuff. That's like her thing.
Yeah.
She turned me on to this girl named Julian Baker, who's like young, real young. I think she's like 17 or 18. I think she's or something. But it's just her and a Telecaster and a twin reverb, and this girl writes songs that are so they're so believable, and they're so like deeply moving and sad. It just like, you're like, how could somebody so young, you know?
Right.
But I mean, I know more than most people, like, you don't have to live a lot of years to see a lot of things, you know?
Yeah.
And apparently she's like sober and like in the program and like all this stuff.
Jeez.
And like she was in a punk band and stuff and just kind of started recording demos in her bedroom, and somehow they got into some hands, and yeah, she just blew up. But yeah, she's interesting. You should check her out.
Yeah, I actually went on to Facebook and liked her page just so I could see some stuff about her. I see she's playing a show. She's playing the High Water show in Charleston next April.
Yeah.
And I've got kids on the East Coast. I might go out there for that. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's very depressing music, but it's very true. It's very real. It's very moving. But you got to be ready for it. You know, it's not light. It's not to be taken lightly at all. Especially, and there's something about the conviction of like a young girl talking about things like that.
Right.
That's even more kind of tear jerking, I guess, you know?
Right, right. There's a broken glass quality to it, right?
Yeah. You just want to like give her a hug, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, her music's catharsis, and it saves her a bit from either the pain or her perception of what she thinks has happened around her, right?
I think that, and I think the fact that like you genuinely get the feeling that she never thought anybody was ever going to hear those songs.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Like she really just wrote them like feel like you're reading someone's journal or diary or something, you know?
But don't you do that? I mean, when you write all your material, I mean, you've put out a lot of material for a young guy. And don't you think the majority of it is some sort of self-fulfilling prophecy or, you know what I mean? You're just,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But I think, like I said, I have 3 million watts behind me and my band plays at light speed.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. A lot to like hide behind.
Yeah.
I have a nice cushion. It's like when it's just you and a guitar, that's terrifying to me.
Are you going to do totally it? Are you going to do it someday?
Definitely. Definitely. I definitely want to. I also, one thing I want to do in my life is I definitely want to like do, I want to try at least once to do stand-up comedy.
Interesting.
Because I think stand-up comedy is the most terrifying form of performance art I can think of. I mean, and I think my dad would probably say the exact same thing. I had a dream once that I can remember so vividly that I was getting ready for a show, you know? And they're like, okay, you know, 10 minutes, 7 minutes, 5 minutes. All right, you got 2 minutes. And they're like, okay, we're ready for you. And I'm like, well, where's my band? You know, they're like, what are you talking about? And it turned out I was like, I was I was doing stand-up comedy, and I had no idea.
Wow.
And they were like, you gotta go on stage, like, now. And I was like, I don't have anything prepared. I'm not, I don't have any material. And I woke up as soon as I walked on stage. But I just remember that feeling of, I was walking down a hallway to like walk on stage and thinking, shit, what am I going to do? You know, and like, not only that, like, I have so much respect for comedians because bombing is part of it, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I've never been booed off stage.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah. Yeah, bombing lets them know what works, what doesn't work about a joke. Because the reality is a lot of it's great, right? But it's a timing thing or a delivery thing, or there's an aspect of the joke that is maybe too self-referential. There's something that takes the audience out of it and they let you know, right?
Or where you are.
Yeah, yeah.
You're not going to go to Arkansas and tell the same jokes that you're telling in San Francisco.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
They're not going to go over the same. They're not.
Music gives you a pass, doesn't it?
I just think it's so brave. I think it's so brave. I think it's such a noble, brave form of art. It literally, it's like, okay, I want you to go out on stage for an hour and make 350 people laugh. For an hour. You have to make everybody in this room laugh for an hour.
Yeah.
That's horrifying, man. Yeah,
it doesn't, you can't, I don't think you can, let me stop. I think about it all the time, actually. I think about the same thing you do, that I would love a shot at it, but I think my ego, I don't think I could handle it because I know I have moments that are funny, but am I funny as a comedian? No. I think I have natural skills like anybody. Anybody can pop a joke and it works, right? But I mean, I find myself even recently, maybe even a month ago, standing in my shower getting ready for bed and I'm in there telling jokes. I'm crafting jokes in the shower. Have you ever done this?
Kinda.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's just a really great place to like work on your material, right? You're by yourself, you're warm, you know what I mean? And I'm just in there like, hey, you know, this time, you know, and I start talking and telling this joke and trying to figure out a way to do it. And I've actually come out of the shower and told jokes to my wife and she thought they were good. And of course, granted, she's my wife, so she's going to agree with me. But yeah, when I really think about it, Thomas, yeah, it just, I'd rather jump out of an airplane again. You know what I mean? I'd rather do that again.
Yeah, and I wouldn't do that either.
Yeah, but I did that.
My fiance did that, and she like swears it was one of the most exhilarating things she's ever done. You know, she also has tattoos up to her chin, so she's a psychopath.
Okay.
But I love her. I'm not jumping out of an airplane. No, thank you. You can do that.
Yeah.
I actually have kind of done the same thing, but like, I'll think I have the best joke, like the funniest joke. I'd be like, Jenica, and like pop it on her and she'll just look at me like, that's it. You know, like, you better take that one back to the shower, buddy. Like, that's not going to go over. She's pretty brutal.
Oh my gosh.
She's funny though. She thinks I'm the funniest though, like when I'm not trying. So I think if I was gonna actually do that, I think I'd have to like go the Marc Maron route.
Right. Just sort of, you know, the reality road, right?
Well, I think I'd have to like, I think I'd like try to prepare for it. And I'd like probably like write a bunch of jokes and like stress myself out, and then at the last second go like, fuck it. You know, and just throw the notebook in the trash and walk out on stage and just go for it. I think that's how I would have to do it.
Yeah.
Because that's kind of how I do it with music, to be honest. You know, like the minute I start thinking too much about like a show or a performance is the minute that I kind of stop having fun. And if I'm not having fun, you're not going to get that conviction that we've been kind of toying with this whole conversation.
Yeah.
No matter what we've been talking about.
Yeah. No, it's true. It's true. You know, it's funny. Watching you reminds me of an old Vendetta Red show. You ever go see those guys when they were in town?
I know them very well.
Yeah, I had a feeling.
We played many shows with them, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And whatever happened to them, I mean, I know this interview is not about them, but I just lost track of them. I heard they signed with Epic or something like that, got a development deal, and they just kind of went away.
Yeah, I think, I know the Epic thing happened. I know it didn't pan out well.
Yeah.
Some members left. There was some issues internally.
Sure.
And just kind of
like every other band, right?
Yeah, it just happens. I mean, sometimes the wheels fall off, you know.
Yeah, they had a ton of energy though. I just remember seeing them down at the showbox, but off ramp, you know, El Corazon,
probably Graceland at the time.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Awesome stuff, man.
Definitely. And yeah, and there was so much of that, and I miss that. I miss that in rock and roll nowadays, you know?
Yeah. So tell us why did Fall of Troy get back together? What was the impetus for that? Because I'm sure that, I mean, I can make a lot of assumptions. I could probably go read it on the internet, but I really want to know what...
You know what? It's really simple. We missed each other, and we missed rocking out.
Yeah.
We missed playing our songs, but I think we missed each other, you know? We never liked how it went down the first time, and it was really that simple.
Yeah. And you guys love each other, right? I mean, you love each other.
Yeah. No matter what we do. I mean, there's a lot of issues. It's been a lot of years. A lot of different things going on in a lot of different people's lives now too. But we'll always be friends. And that's the important part, you know, is that we're friends before anything else, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think it was more just an excuse to get us together, you know?
Yeah, and then you'd rediscover that thing and it's on, right?
Yeah, I don't even think we thought about it. We just did.
That's so cool. And you had Legacy already going in, right? So as soon as you sort of make the announcement that, hey, we're back, you're getting label and tour opportunities, right?
Sure, but we put our record out on our own and toured on our own. The only real person we had working for us since we've been back together is our booking agent.
Okay. Okay.
Like, we haven't had like real management.
Right. Cause you've always controlled it. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
We've done everything DIY on our own again.
That is so cool. Have you ever thought of teaching a class on how to do it? Because so many bands wish they were, you know, in your position. You know,
absolutely not. I mean, I mean, yes, but no.
Sure. No, I get it. I mean, it was really.
I would rather teach a class on what not to do.
Right.
You know what I mean? At this point.
Right. Well, certainly more facetious. I can't imagine you actually sitting down with all of your energy and saying, "So
if
this
I
is what you do."
If I knew then what I know now, kind of thing.
Right. Right. do you have a period? I mean, I would imagine you do, and everybody has one in their life as an artist, but where you felt the least inspired, whether it was, you know, you looking back now, you say that release just wasn't to the level I needed it to be, or I put it out too fast, or we weren't prepared, or we were in a bad space. Do you mind talking about, you know, a moment in your career that was kind of uninspired?
I mean, I think I back every record the Fall of Troy has made. Like, I like them all for different reasons.
Okay.
In the Unlikely Event is a very hard record for me to like listen to.
Why?
More so because I was personally lost.
Okay.
It was dark days, you know? The original name of the album was In the Unlikely Event That the Fall of Troy Breaks Up After This Album Comes Out.
Wow.
And we were like, yeah, I don't think that's going to fly with the label. So we just named it In the Unlikely Event. But like, it was our suicide note, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Like, we already knew, we knew when we were recording it that it was our last record, you know? So it was sad, you know? But as far as like uninspired goes, like, I don't know. We've never gone halfway in,
yeah.
You know? Even if the whole world's been falling apart around us, like, we still put everything we had into our band, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. You guys seem like the string quartet on the Titanic, right? You're just going down with the ship, but you're going to make it good all the way down.
Yep.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I love that. I love that so much. You know, a local friend of mine, young girl, younger than you, I was having coffee with her the other day. And she was asking me about my podcast, and I said, I'm hoping to interview the singer from Fall of Troy. And she looks at me. She goes, what? And I go with the Fall of Troy, you know, Thomas Erak. And she goes, oh my God, serious? You know, she did that thing, right? The kid thing that just cannot believe you're talking to their idol, right? And she actually asked me to ask you a question. So if you don't mind, I'd like to ask a question from a fan. Her name is Lexi Tretevic. She lives in North Bend, Washington.
And, hi, Lexi.
She's gonna freak out when she hears your voice say that. She asks, "What's the most meaningful song you've written, and why?"
Oh boy. It's going to sound so lame, but like, I mean, that's like asking to choose your favorite kid.
Of course.
You know?
Yeah, of course. I get it.
It's not really answerable.
Give me a couple.
And it changes. Yeah. It changes from tonight too. Like, you know, depending on what's going on in my life, certain songs I connect to better at certain times than others. I gotta marinate on that for like a second.
Okay. No struggle.
And other songs that I've written at the time that meant a lot to me that don't mean as much now. And then there's songs that at the time I kind of just train of thought wrote them, and now they mean a lot to me. I don't know. Like, I guess. One of the ones that jumps out at me just like off the top of my head, like that's more recent, I guess.
Right.
You know, cause it's kind of hard to go back to 2005 right now, or whatever, 2007. But as far as recently, there's a song on our most recent record called Okay, called A Single Word.
Okay.
And the single word is love.
Nice.
And like the whole point of the song is I'm kind of trying to like, you're like trying to tell someone that you love them, but it's like too late because they've like changed.
Right. Right.
You know, like, and you like, you don't love them anymore. Like you love what they used to be.
Right.
And you're kind of like trying to, you know, it's a hard thing to explain, but it's definitely like something that I've gone through. And, you know, it's hard to like falling out of love sucks, man. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, it does. It's terrible.
It's hard to be falling out of love with, and it's hard, really hard to fall out of love with someone. And, on multiple levels. Yeah. I mean, it's literally difficult, first of all, to give up on someone when you care about them so much. And then when you finally do, it's very painful, you know? So it kind of comes from that place of like that kind of, the aftershock of like, like the hook is like, oh dear God, what have I done? You're not the same anymore. Was all the blood on the walls just a display for the neighbors? Your intoxicating vapors make a fool out of me. You make a fool out of me. You know, like,
That's heavy. That is heavy.
Yeah, it's like, this was all for nothing. You know, it was just a show. Yeah. Or was it? Or what? No, and I don't know. I think we've all been to that place in our lives, or a lot of us have, at least. I like to think that, like, when you're like, was this worth it? Was it not worth it? Was it a waste of time? Was it, what the fuck was this? You know, like, and there's really just not really ever an answer.
Yeah.
Like, I think the hardest thing for me in my life is like closure. Like, I need closure on things. Like, if I don't get closure, I'm very confused, you know, and it becomes very, it really bothers me, you know, if I don't get closure. Even if, I'd rather someone be like, yo, fuck off, I don't like you, I don't want to be friends,
right,
leave me alone, than just like ignore me, you know, or play nice to my face and then talk shit behind my back. Like, I just, you
right,
know,
right, right, to hang around and make you think that maybe, just maybe, they find you valuable, or maybe they want to be friends.
Yeah,
because you see them differently than they see you. You see them. You see their capability and their and who they well, that they're at least creating themselves to be in front of you. But the reality is it's a front, and it's just hurtful. I'm a big wuss about it.
What's really painful too, when you fall out of love with somebody, is like, especially if you still like love them, is like to see them shine and laugh and be happy when they're talking to other people in public.
Yeah.
Then you talk to them and they just turn into this, you know, that all goes away. The beauty in them goes away, and you feel like it's your fault, and you, all you really wanted to do was like bring that thing that you're seeing out in them, but for whatever reason you took it away from them.
Yeah.
And it's like totally the opposite of what you wanted to do, you know? And that is just, I don't care who you are, man, that's some hard shit to stomach, you know?
Yeah.
And it's closure in that for me. So yeah, I have a hard time. I have a hard time with that sentiment, I guess. So that song jumps out at me because I wrote that song about that subject, you
right,
know?
Right, right. Do you feel, you know, I listened to you talk, and this entire chat tonight has been about how we feel, how you feel, uh-huh, you know, how your heart aches and loves and lives, and how really everything you do is about love and the inspiration of love and the perspiration of love, right? All those things, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The emotional, the subliminal, all that stuff. How does Thomas feel about love right now? Like, how do you feel as a man? I mean, again, if this is something you don't want to talk about, I can cut this out, or you could just pass.
No, I'm an open book, man.
Yeah, I feel like I'm in a counseling session, and I really love what you're saying. You know, I really love what you're saying.
How do I feel about love right now? Like,
yeah,
are we talking about
you?
Like romantic love?
You define it. I'm just hearing
there's lots of different kinds of love. That's why it's so endless, because there's so many different kinds. I think that's why it's so fascinating and always has been to me, because there's so many different types of love. You know, there's the way I love my dad. There's the way I love my mom. There's the way I love grandma. There's the way I love Jenica. There's the way I love her son. You know, there's the way I love my sister, you know?
I get that. I hear it coming from you in such a powerful way. I mean, it's just exuding out of you. But there's this, to me, I mean, if you don't mind me saying this, I want to say this because I just feel it. I feel like you're lonely. I feel like you're in Detroit and everybody you love except for Jenica and her son is somewhere else. And I just feel like you're longing for them,
But that's the beauty.
Yeah.
That's the beauty, you know? Longing is one of the best things, man. It makes you really step back and appreciate what you have.
Yeah.
You know?
That's so true.
No, and I have friends out here, you know?
Sure.
I have friends out here and stuff, but, you know, to be totally fucking straight up, like, I didn't uproot my life in Seattle and leave my family and friends to come out here and make some pals at the bar.
Right, right.
I came out to be with Jenica and her son.
Yeah.
That's what I'm doing.
It's pretty badass. Pretty badass, dude.
And right now, love to me is work. You got to work. You got to work for love. It's not just something that just, it doesn't just survive on its own, you know? You gotta take care of it. You gotta be careful with it. You gotta sometimes you gotta let it chill for a minute. Sometimes you gotta not let it go anywhere. Sometimes, you know,
right.
Devotion, man. Devotion, I guess. It's work, you know. Every day is a new adventure, and I get to, you know what? I told Jenica this. Here you go. I told Jenica this the other night, again, when we were having our long late night talk, and I was talking to my grandma one time before my grandpa passed, and I had just I think I had gone through a breakup or something, and I was in high school and I was heartbroken, and I was like, Grandma, how do you do it? Like, how have you been married to Grandpa for 60 years? Like, how are you guys still in love? You know? And she was like, well, Thomas, you know, we have our good days, we have our bad days. We have our good months, we have our bad months. We have our good years, we have our bad years. But they're ours.
Nice.
That's some heavy shit, man.
Yeah.
Some perfect. Heavy fucking shit, dude.
It's perfect, though. It's perfect. And that's the truth, right?
If you knew my grandparents, if you knew what they were like, they are the reason I believe in true love.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what every marriage should be, you know?
Yeah.
They're the same person. But to hear my grandmother say that, we've had our good years, we've had our bad years.
Yeah, it's hard to believe.
But they're ours. We're together. You know, we do it together.
Yeah.
For better or for worse. You know? Till death do us part. That's what you say, right?
Yep.
So fucking do it. Nobody does it anymore. Or just don't get married.
Yeah.
Don't damn that. You know what I mean? I take that very seriously, man.
Yeah.
I just don't, you know? People just, I don't know. so careless with love now.
Yeah.
So careless.
Yeah.
I'm guilty of it too sometimes, you know?
Oh, yeah?
Everybody is.
Yeah? You think you're careless still?
Not intentionally, but yeah, sometimes. Yeah. I mean, I can be a dick.
Yeah, take things for granted. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was just going to say, I don't want to interview myself, right? I mean, I love what you're saying, Thomas. It just makes me think about my own relationship with my wife and the fact, you know, I mean, we've been together since 1997, so we're coming up on our 20th year together. And
it's great.
Yeah, and you know what? When I met her, I knew it was that weird intangible thing. It wasn't that she was just super cute, because she is. It was that I just knew. And I went home. I love to tell this story. I went home and I sat in my house and I sat on my couch and I put my arm around my imaginary girlfriend and I put together all the words I would say to her if she were mine. I did. I was 30 years old.
You are so cheesy, dude.
I know. And I was talking. I had my arm around. I was sitting on my futon and I'm talking to my imaginary girlfriend who's next door at the house next door. And
your roommate comes out with a cup of noodles and I'm like, what the fuck are you
exactly
doing?
Exactly. It's totally what's going on. But the next day, so you don't know this, but I had been married before, and marriage failed pretty fast, but I had three children. So I had a lot of baggage and a lot of damage
guilt?
Control and guilt. Yeah. And so I was trying to be a better dad because that was in my music years, right? That's when I was doing work and traveling around and doing some touring and doing sessions. You know, I was busy all the time and I wasn't at home. I wasn't a good husband. I wasn't a good dad. It sucked. So I was trying to make up for it.
Yeah.
And my kids are coming over. But my daughter, had her sixth birthday. And I went next door where I'd seen this girl. And I said, if you guys want to come over tomorrow to my daughter's birthday party, I'd really like to, you know, I'd like you to be welcome. And so my wife is Japanese, by the way. So all these Japanese girls come over, and here she is. Here she is in the middle of this, and I'm in heaven because they're all beautiful.
And you're like, konnichiwa.
Exactly. Like, yeah. And of course, I'm doing this. Je m'appelle Robert, because I'm speaking in French because I'm so nervous. I can't write. I'm just being a complete idiot. And anyway, we did the birthday party, and I'm playing frisbee out in the front yard. And my son, he throws me a frisbee. I catch it between my legs. And he goes, Dad, you're showing off because you like that girl. Right? That's the first thing he says. So he outs me.
Roasted.
Exactly. So I'm talking to my friend who lives next door. It's a woman I really care for, good friend of mine. And she's always wanted to be a matchmaker. And so I walk up to her, and her name is Chip. And I go, hey, Chip. I said, see that girl over there? I've seen her a couple of days in a row. You want to match make me to her. So that night, she went back and she told the Japanese exchange student that was staying with them that, hey, Rob next door really likes that girl. Do you think you can kind of put them together? So we had a movie night at my house. I'm a big movie fanatic, and we had this, you know, big screen and everything else, and we had 30 people at my house. And we had 30 people in my living room, and yet magically the only space available next to me on the couch was for her. And
that was by design?
Of course. Yeah, no, by design. It was gorgeous. Everybody's looking at magic. Her. Right, yeah. But they, you know, they put her down and sat her down next to me, and I remember thinking, like, I could not love or maybe even lust after somebody more in my life. Like, I mean, she was perfect. She looked perfect. Yeah. She talked perfect. She was funny. She was cute. She was endearing. She was all these things. And I remember thinking, which is foolish, I remember thinking, it will never be hard. It'll never, ever be hard.
Oh, God. Come on.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, I was in such an overload of...
I know the feeling.
Yeah, of happiness and testosterone and everything else. Yeah. You know, it's like, it'll never, ever be difficult. And, you know, 3 months later, it's like all hell's breaking loose. And I remember thinking, like, I don't know. You know, I don't understand. I don't understand why it has to be so hard so fast. But point being is, you know, a year and a half later, we were married. And... Yeah. And it was, and there was moments of incredible joy and moments of absolutely searing pain, searing worst kind of stuff you can imagine, the worst things you could ever imagine.
Oh, but, I know it.
But you know, but dude, two things came out of that for me that I'll never forget. And the first thing was what my wife said to me. When things were hard, she said, you know what the difference is between you and I? You're here. You've been here. You speak the language. Everybody you know is here. Everything you know is here. I gave every one of those things up to be with you.
Yeah, she sounds like me.
You know what I mean? Yeah. But I needed to hear that because I was being unintentionally arrogant. I was like, what's so hard? This is great. You know what I mean? But what I realized was love wasn't, I mean, for the first time in my life, all of a sudden I was at the time, probably 34. I mean, it took me like 4 years of being with her before before she said that to me, but it took until I was 34 to finally get, you know, how to kind of define love, which for me was, it's not about how you feel. It's about how much are you willing to honor them when you despise them, right? That's love to me. When you're willing to hang in there, bear through the most difficult things because there's something about them that deserves respect. And you're there to provide it for them. You promised yourself to them in a way that nobody else has.
Promise.
Yeah, how dare you take that away from them? It's your responsibility to find a way to fill their lives with joy and with love and respect and honor and faithfulness and all those things. All these things that we ask of God, right? I mean, I know you said, and we're not going to talk about religion, but you know, there's so many people out there that are like, I just want God to love me and make my life better. What I want to do is be the very best human being I can be, because to me, If God exists, I'm the representation of Him, right?
That's right.
If I'm hanging out with Thomas and I'm a shitbird, well, then God must be a shitbird.
That's right.
You know what I mean? I want to be the very best I can be. Pardon?
Yeah. And Jenica has expressed to me before that just, you know, she gets very frustrated with me sometimes when I'm lazy.
Right.
You know, like, and she gets really frustrated when I'm unmotivated. She doesn't like that. Turns her off. She doesn't like it, and it bums her out. But it's only because she wants me to be the best Thomas I can be. You know, because she knows how dope I can be sometimes, you know. She knows what I'm capable of, and even when I don't feel like, even when I don't feel like it, you know.
Yeah, no doubt.
So you know, that's a tough thing about being with somebody too, is, you know, quirks and personalities and things like that. It's about how you deal with those things and how you communicate, I guess, right, more than anything else. Communication's huge, and respect is huge.
So how much has Jenica spoken into your life, in your material, your new music, the things you're doing now?
What do you mean?
Well, meaning how much has she influenced your life, or how, are you finding that she's a new muse for you? Because, I mean, I don't know how long she's been in your life, but I'm curious how your relationship and the love you have for her and the things she brings out of you influences your music. You know, what does it do to you to make you better?
She's been in my life for quite a few years.
Okay.
But we've only been romantic for like a little over a year.
Okay.
But there's always been spark. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It just, we were really good friends and always kept in touch and talked a lot. But she was always, I don't know, I guess I'll put it this way. All the other girls were just girls.
Right.
Like, she was a woman. You know what I mean?
I totally get that.
Like, I put her in a different class. You know what I mean? Like, I still do, but especially back then, I didn't even think about like, oh man, I wish Jenica was my girlfriend, you know? Cause I was just like, that was like a pipe dream, homie. That was like, she is way too cool and smart and successful to want fucking anything to do with me on that level. You know, yeah. Like she's not that dumb.
That's great.
So either she's that dumb or somebody did some growing up the last, you know, 4 years, 5 years.
Sure.
Or maybe we both did.
Yeah, life together. Is about timing, right? You've heard that, right? Life is about timing.
Totally, man. Yeah, absolutely. Love is about timing, too.
Yeah.
Like, because we just missed each other always.
Yeah.
You know, it's like she had a boyfriend or I had a girlfriend or we both had significant others or, you know, it was we never were just able to be anything other than friends, you know? And I liked her music and I just thought she was cool. I just wanted to know her, you know?
Yeah.
And that's kind of where I started to think that I loved her. Because I didn't feel like that about anybody else. You know, I didn't feel like that about any other girl or woman that I knew. I wasn't just like, I just want her in my life, you know? She has to be in my life, you know?
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, and I just started to notice it, and the story goes way deeper than that, and yeah, she's a really wonderful person, and she's really shown me a lot of things, and I think I've shown her a lot of things, and I think she saved my life in ways.
Right.
Like, definitely. I mean, she literally has definitely saved my life one time specifically, but multiple times and otherwise. But yeah, man, like, she is not afraid to be herself, and she is not afraid to tell me, well, what's up, you know? And I have so much respect for that, and I have so much respect for her that I actually listen to her, which is insane, because I don't listen to anybody, ever.
Wow. Wow. Well, at least you're admitting it in public. That's amazing.
I mean, I do. No, I listen to people, but it's up to my discretion if I'm going to, you know.
Interact.
Yeah, like, you know, take heed or not. Or I don't know if that's what I'm looking for, but I don't know. Just everything that she says feels like there's weight to it, you know?
Sure.
And the only other person I can really think of that I like when they talk to me, like, serious, like, yo, listen up, that I listen to like that is my sister, is my big sister.
Wow.
You know?
Is Jenica older?
My big sister is also, like, the most fun, loving person I know. You know what I mean?
Right,
like,
right.
She's so much fun. But if she's like, Thomas, you know what I mean? Like, she does. She gets this voice.
Like your dad talking to her.
No, I'll tell my dad to go fuck himself. Like, my sister's the only person I've ever met.
Your poor dad.
That has choked me. You know?
Right.
She choked me to the ground one time because I was being a little brat about going to my grandma's house. She was like, if you're not in the car by the time I count to 10, I'm coming back down here and I'm going to beat the shit out of you. And I was like 13 or 14. She was like probably 16 or 17. I was like, whatever, I'm bigger than you now. Blah, blah, blah. She comes downstairs and I went to say some smart ass thing to her and she just grabbed me by the throat and put me on the ground and scared me so bad. I never fucked with her ever again. I never messed with her ever again. Like not like that, you know. I mean, we've had disagreements and stuff, but I never like talked shit to Gail again after that.
Crazy.
And that, so yeah, and she's rational. She's not like me. She's not an irrational, emotional artist, you know, freak of nature like me and my dad. She's like a rational human being. That has to deal with me and my dad. Can you imagine that?
Oh, no. Your dad's hard enough. And I mean, you and I have never met face to face, but between your introspection and your father's type A personality, I'd probably be doomed.
Well, okay. And then imagine me and my dad together.
Yeah. No, it's too much. It's too much. And I like you guys. It's just
too
much.
It's actually pretty fun. It's actually pretty fun, man.
Yeah, no, I'm sure. I would love to. I can't wait to play with your dad. We've been talking about getting together finally and just going and just trading fours for like 2 hours somewhere.
You know? Oh, yeah, yeah. You totally should, man.
Yeah, yeah. He's a killer player. Can I ask you a few questions before I let you go?
Yes, sir.
So, you know, what I never do this, but because this conversation has been so introspective and really hasn't been about, you know, tour life and, you know, storytelling on the road and all those traditional things you might have done in the past, I did want to ask you one question about touring, and then I was hoping to play a little word association game with you and then let you go, let you go for the night, okay?
Yeah, awesome.
So my daughter, Kaya, she's a 25-year-old, lives here in North Bend as well, and she's one of my favorite people in the whole world. And she inherited my taste for music, and she listens to a little bit of everything. And tonight she was at my house. She was helping me with one of my kids, and one of her sister, I should say. And she said, "Did you ever talk to Thomas?" And I said, "Well, not yet. I'm actually talking to him tonight." And she said, "Well, would you ask him a question?" So I said, "Of course." So it's another question from a fan, my daughter Kaya Jones. And
hi, Kaya.
And she wanted to know, what was your favorite concert that you ever played?
That I ever played?
That you ever played. What was your favorite show?
I'm going to have to say when we sold out the Fillmore in San Francisco.
Yeah, sweet.
I mean, oh, there's so many, though, man. You know, there's so many. But that one sticks out in my mind just because the history.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, you're walking through the hallways, and it's Elton John and Prince. And, I mean, if you can sell out the Fillmore, man. And we did it on our own. You know, we did it without a record label or anything. Like, we did it without big support bands. It was, like, pretty much us and our friends' bands that we liked to watch it play every night.
Right.
And it was just – it just felt like such a proud moment. And I remember telling my dad – I remember calling my dad that night and telling him, dude, we just sold out the Fillmore.
Wow.
And he started crying.
Yeah.
You know, because like he knew the importance of that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely. I mean, it made me cry. It made me emotional. So wow. I'd have to say that one. Other than that, like, London is always a trip, man. Like, we played the Electric Ballroom. Not the last. I mean, the last time we were there, we didn't play Electric Ballroom. We played another place. But the time before that, we played the Electric Ballroom and sold that out. And that was just, from start to finish, was just incredible.
Wow.
Yeah. Japan. whatever.
Yeah, where's your favorite place in Japan?
Tokyo, dude.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely.
Why Tokyo? I'm a huge Kansai guy, so Osaka.
Because it's outer space, man.
It is. It's outer space. It is.
Have you been?
Oh, yeah, many times. My favorite part about Japan, I shouldn't say it this way. Let me say it differently.
Oh, yeah, your wife's Japanese.
Yeah. No, it's cool. I had a friend from Norway who I met in Japan in 2001. I was at an amusement park, and we were sitting in a water park, and he just hanging out, and he's this really cool guy from Norway. So we ended up becoming friends. But that first day, I said, "What's your experience in Japan been like so far?" And he said, "You know what? This country, the best way I figured out how to describe it or how to define it is it's the land of Zen and sugar-free cotton candy."
Yep.
It's just so freaking weird and cool and awesome and confusing. Yeah, it's outer space. It's awesome. Okay. Thank you for that answer. So I'm going to ask you just a few questions, and they're going to be like one or two word phrases, and I just want your thoughts. You can give one word answers, you can give paragraphs, you can talk for 10 minutes. I don't care. I just want to ask you about some things, and then I'll let you go. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Gibson guitars.
They sponsor me. I love them.
Yes. Chon.
Two of the most talented brothers I know.
High school drum lines.
They either are awesome or they suck.
That's a good answer. I like that. 30 Years War.
The Fall of Troy.
The Fall of Troy.
Same thing.
That's not fair, man. You're supposed to speak on that. Come on. Favorite
it's
genre.
The same thing.
No, I got you. I know. Favorite genre.
Sports, The Fall of Troy, and then we changed our name.
I know. I was just hoping you would give me a story, but that's cool. Your favorite
genre. There's no big story.
Yeah. You just changed the name.
Yeah. We had another guitar player. He left. We changed our name.
Okay. Okay. Current favorite genre.
Of what?
Music.
Music?
Mm-hmm.
Current. Hip hop.
Okay. I
like this game.
Yeah. Your biggest weakness.
Oh. I have to think about that for a second. I think I don't know when to stop sometimes.
Good answer.
Sometimes you just gotta know like when to quit, you know what I'm saying? And sometimes it's hard for me to leave it alone.
Yeah. Tom Erak Sr.
We have different middle names, so I've never met him. But I know Tom Howard Erak.
I know.
The reason that I have a different middle name than my dad, and my dad's not actually a senior, is because...
Oh, he's not. I thought he was a senior. Okay. I apologize. Yeah.
Oh, no, that's fine. A lot of people think that. But the reason that I'm not junior is because my dad was like, no, I don't want him to have the same middle name as me because he is going to hate being called junior.
Oh.
And he was so right. Because if people were like, hey, Tom Junior, I'd be like, no.
Wow.
So yeah. He called that thing, you know, before I even came out. So props to dad on that one.
Biggest influence?
My dad.
That's good enough, buddy. That's good enough. You've knocked me all around tonight. I thought for sure, I really did. I thought for sure you would
answer things in a very predictable way, and you've kept me not only on my toes or on my heels, but on the back of my chair. I am absolutely lost, and it's been incredible. I mean, you've given me so much time, and I just can't believe what you've shared with me tonight, and I just, how gracious and wonderful this is. And so thank you from the bottom of my heart. I mean, I'm really, really just impressed with you as a person, and I hope I hope when you come back out to this area, man, just a chance to meet with you and maybe, you know, buy you a drink or a cup of coffee or lunch or whatever and just spend some time and pick your brain apart. I would love that. And if you ever want to play with the little people, I would love to sit in with you one of these days and play a tune.
Definitely, man. Yeah, definitely. I mean, likewise on most of that for me. And thanks for going down the rabbit hole with me and not just like, you know, shooting me lame questions about like where we got our name and asking me what's the craziest thing that's ever happened on tour.
Yeah. I mean, I think your fans, I mean, I'm a fan, but you know what I mean? I think the fans have already heard that. You've been asked it a million times, and yeah, why do we need to talk about it?
Yeah. We have Wikipedia.
Pardon?
You know?
Say again?
We have a Wikipedia.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So before I let you go, I want to ask you one favor if I can. You can tell me no, and it's cool. So on Doppelganger, again, you have I Just Got This Symphony Going. It's probably yes. It's probably my favorite release of yours. And I was wondering, can I add it to the back end of the podcast so people who don't know your material, they can hear it?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'm not asking them. Obviously, I'm not going to monetize it or anything. I want to make sure you guys, you know, everybody's going to have full credits, etc. But I just want to make sure it's cool I do it because I really want people to hear your stuff.
Yeah, but you should play something off of OK.
Okay. So you tell me which track you want me to play off of OK, and then
play a single word since we talked about that one earlier.
Perfect.
What was her name? Lexi.
Yeah. Wow, you have it. Wow, dude, you're gonna freak Lexi out twice because you've remembered her name. That is great. I will do that, I promise. So thank you, man, and I'll make sure you know when this is live. It's gonna come out probably Sunday night, but it might be the following Sunday. Either way, I'll let you know. And just, I really dig this, man. Thank you so much. It's been an absolute joy.
Thanks for having me, Rob. You're a great dude.
Yeah, thanks, man. Have a great night. Sleep well.
Later, bud.
Bye.